At Bernie Sanders' 2020 campaign kickoff rally, I want to remind you of a very specific criticism that former Hillary Clinton staffer Zerlina Maxwell had on MSNBC about Bernie Sanders' speech.
But look, there were a couple times that you had a couple eye rolls, and just explain your thoughts as you were listening to Bernie Sanders.
Look, I work for Hillary Clinton, so I have a lot of opinions.
That was
about,
it, right there.
Bernie Sanders. But, you know, to be very serious about it, I clocked it. He did not mention race or gender until 23 minutes into the speech. And just for point of comparison, I went back and looked at Elizabeth Warren's opening speech, for example. She mentions race and discrimination in the first paragraph. So that's a big difference.
Except Bernie Sanders actually did do what she claimed he did not do. As Waleed Shaheed points out, at the 3-minute mark, he thanked Sean King for his work on criminal justice reform. At the 6-minute mark, he discussed fighting Trump's sexism and racism. At the 13-minute mark, he discussed mass incarceration. Now, once she was called out and fact-checked, really, she then kind of backtracked and stated, "Okay, I've rewatched since yesterday, and while I can't acknowledge that I missed the passing line at 6 minutes, I stand by my point, since talking about criminal justice is not the same thing as talking about race and gender, and if you don't get why, Bernie won't win. Again." So obviously she refused to take the L, even though she was thoroughly refuted. And she claims, look, talking about criminal justice reform is not the same thing as talking about sex and gender. Except in the actual tweet by Waleed Shaheed that she quote tweeted when she responded there, at the 6-minute mark, Bernie Sanders did talk about racism and sexism, specifically within the context of fighting Donald Trump's racism and sexism. So either she lacks reading or listening comprehension skills, or she's just being purposefully obtuse so she can smear Bernie Sanders in any way possible. And I will assume it's the latter, because Zerlina Maxwell is a very intelligent person. I think she knows what she's doing, and she's trying to interpret what Bernie Sanders is saying in the least charitable way possible so she can make him look bad, because she's a former Clinton staffer, and as she admitted in that clip, you know, she has some feelings about this. So she doesn't have any credibility at all, but nonetheless, she was still on Bill Maher's show, and they were talking about Bernie's appearance at a recent She the People event, where he was actually booed when asked about the federal government's role in fighting white nationalism. And when the hosts followed up, because they didn't feel as if Bernie Sanders adequately answered the question, he mentioned how he marched with MLK, and he was subsequently booed because he brought that up. And what a YouTube channel called Spitting Back did was they actually fact-checked her in real time as she talked about this on Bill Maher's show, and everything she says Bernie should have done, they play the clip of Bernie Sanders doing exactly what she said he didn't do. Now, to be clear here, she was talking specifically about Bernie Sanders' answer about white nationalism, but nonetheless, if she would have tuned in to see his full interview, everything she recommended that he do, he did do throughout the course of this interview. And it's bizarre. So take a look at this compilation here, because it really speaks to how hacky Zerlina Maxwell is.
The women in the audience wanted to hear specifics, and Bernie Sanders did not answer the question. That's what the boos were for.
And that means, by the way, not only specific plans and programs, it means a fundamental change in the culture of this country. Discrimination of all forms has got to end, period. And you do that using the bully puppet, and you use that doing legislation.
What should he have said?
I think he needs to talk about specifics.
Like what? What was the right answer?
Let's talk about pay equity.
We will not accept discrimination in the workforce. It means that we will end the absurdity of women in general making 80 cents on the dollar compared to men, and minority women making a whole lot less than that. When we talk about minority communities, when we raise that federal minimum wage to a living wage of 15 bucks an hour, you're going to do away with a lot of economic stress in this country.
Let's talk about discrimination. Let's talk about making sure that families, no matter where they are, no matter what color, have quality education.
Every person in this country, regardless of color, regardless of income, has the right to get a higher education, because we're going to make public colleges and universities tuition free. And we are going to very substantially end the burden of outrageous levels of student debt in this country.
Access to affordable health care, all the other issues that Democrats talk about,
said,
and tailor it
do everything I can to help
the constituency you're
talking lead this
to.
Country.
And when we talk about justice, we are also talking about the massive levels of racial disparities that exist in this country. It's not just that we need health care for all people. We need to address the fact that infant mortality in the African-American community is 2.5 times what it is in the white community.
And it sounds like you're demanding he say the exact words that are in your head.
No, I'm demanding that he speak in more than platitudes.
As President of the United States, I will appoint Supreme Court justices and nominate justices all across the board who will represent the needs of people of color, of working people, and who are prepared to believe and fight for justice, not just the people on top. But I think what we can do is something fairly novel, is that after a member of the Supreme Court serves for a certain period of time, perhaps 12 years or so, that justice then rotates to an appeals court. That'll give you some fresh blood.
I do believe this country needs a constitutional amendment enshrining the rights of women.
I do.
The political system in this country has been the default. What do white men think? What do white working class men think? And now that we have more representation and the electorate, we're going to be a majority-minority country in 2046. And so now we actually have to have representation that reflect the electorate
you're assuming,
and talk about the issues and how they impact
people of color.
My administration will look like America. Representatives from people who understand the pain and the struggle that working people and minorities are currently feeling. It will be an administration reflecting all of our people who are prepared to stand up for economic, social, and racial justice.
Black unemployment is double white unemployment.
And then within the midst of all of that income and wealth disparity at a national level, we have racial disparities as well. White families have 10 times the wealth of black families.
Now, believe it or not, that video actually goes on longer. So I'm going to link you to the full video by spitting back down below. I'd also encourage you to follow the people who put together that compilation because that really was phenomenal work. That was citizen journalism that really demonstrates how crucial it is in a mainstream media landscape that wouldn't necessarily do something like this. Now, to Bill Maher's credit, he actually kind of did push back against Zerlina Maxwell, but it really goes to show you that she's looking for reasons to criticize Bernie Sanders. She's not trying to be objective. She has a very specific goal. It is to bring down Bernie Sanders no matter what. Doesn't matter if I interpret him, you know, disingenuously. It doesn't matter if I smear him. I just want to defeat Bernie, and that is my number one goal. And I think it's really rich that, of all people, a former Clinton staffer said he should answer with more specificity and not just give off platitudes. You supported Hillary Clinton. You have no room to talk here. You don't have a single leg to stand on because your candidate, what was her slogan again? I'm with her, stronger together. Hillary had nothing but platitudes. She talked less about policy than other Democrats. So, I mean, how can you even say with a straight face that Bernie should lay off the platitudes when you supported Hillary Clinton and worked for her? Why would you want to be so brazenly hacky if your whole job as a journalist and as a political commentator is to maintain legitimacy so people take what you say seriously? Now, again, to be fair to Zerlina Maxwell, something she'd never do to Bernie, she was talking about things she would have liked in Bernie Sanders' answer about white supremacy, that specific question. But nonetheless, in a broader context, one of her criticisms about Bernie is he doesn't really address these key issues here that she was touching on. But throughout the course of when she was criticizing Bernie, what the Spitting Back YouTube channel demonstrated with that compilation was that he has been talking about these things. People are so anti-Bernie that they are willing to lob Trumpian attacks against him, things that are easily debunkable if you just watch what Bernie Sanders said. Now, getting back to Bernie Sanders and him being booed, I'm not necessarily concerned with Bernie Sanders being booed, because if he's booed, if the audience doesn't like what he has to say, then that just means that he's going to have to be more introspective and evolve based on what they said. Because back in 2016, when he was at the Netroots Nation conference and he was shouted down, basically, when protesters wanted him to specifically say the names of women who were killed by police, I think that overall, that was a net benefit because it really helped Bernie Sanders to craft his message in a way that shows people that he's listening, that showed those Black Lives Matter protesters that he was taking what they had to say seriously. So even if, you know, if I were Bernie, I would want to bring up the fact that I marched with MLK every single day, because that's such an amazing fact. I still can understand why people would say, look, you can't use that as a crutch. You need to talk about specific policies. But with that being said, he did talk about a lot of specific policies. Now, since we talked about, you know, this clip here where Bernie Sanders was booed, and I criticized, you know, Lena Maxwell for not necessarily, I guess you can say, having a good faith description of what happened at that event, I'll just play you the full clip. I'll give you the full context so you can decide for yourself whether or not Bernie Sanders should have been booed. Overall, I think he probably should not have been booed. But nonetheless, towards the end here, you're going to see that he actually won over most of the audience after he kind of lost them, because they wanted a specific answer and he wasn't answering to their liking. And then he gave them a specific answer and then they liked what he had to say. So I'll leave you with the clip here that I think is important so you can decide for yourself and not get what political hacks want you to think happened out of this event.
What do you believe is the federal government's role to fight against the rise of white nationalism and white terrorist acts? And how do you plan to lead on that in your first year as president? Okay. Thank you.
First of all, but we have got to make it very clear that the type of demagoguery we are seeing from the Trump administration is not what this country is about. And I will do everything that I can to help lead this country in a direction that ends all forms of discrimination, racial discrimination, gender discrimination, and discrimination based on people's sexual orientation. I am the son of an immigrant, the proud son of an immigrant. And I will do everything that I can to make sure that we pass finally in this country comprehensive immigration reform and a path toward citizenship, that we provide immediate legal protection to the 1.8 million young people eligible for the DACA program. So the goal that we have got to establish is to bring our people together around an agenda that speaks to all people. And that means guaranteeing health care to every man, woman, and child as a right, not a privilege. And I'm proud to have led the effort to fight for a Medicare for All single-payer program. It means understanding that when we talk about minority communities, when we raise that federal minimum wage to a living wage of 15 bucks an hour, you're going to do away with a lot of economic stress in this country. So those are some of the things that I think we've got to do.
And let me just follow up, Senator. The core of the question is about, as president, what would you do with the rise of white supremacist violence to protect our communities?
Absolutely. You know, as somebody who I know I date myself a little bit here, but I actually was at the March on Washington with Dr. King back in 1963. And as somebody who actively supported Jesse Jackson's campaign as one of the few white elected officials to do so in 88, I have dedicated my life to the fight against racism and sexism and discrimination of all forms. And as President of the United States, at the very top of our agenda will be the understanding that discrimination of all forms has got to end, period. And you do that using the bully pulpit, and you use that doing legislation. If somebody wants to go around perpetrating hate crimes, that person will pay a very, very heavy price indeed.
Thank you.
Thank you. And I think what the questioner is getting at is a phenomenon that is actually global. We're seeing it throughout Western Europe as well, as influxes of immigrants from the Middle East come in. You're seeing the same kinds of rises of white nationalism.
Well, let me just say a word on that. That's correct.
Yeah. So as president, what would you do to return the U.S. to global leadership on that issue?
Well, you reverse exactly what Trump is doing. Trump is a cowardly, authoritarian president who is trying, he hides the reality that he has tried to throw 30-plus million people off health care, give huge tax breaks to billionaires, cut Medicare, cut Medicaid, and education. You can't win an election doing that. So what do? You do what demagogues in Europe and in this country have always done. You scapegoat. You go after immigrants. You go after people of color. You go after minorities. You say those people are the problem. It's not Wall Street. It's not the drug companies, it's not the insurance companies, it is undocumented immigrants. That is demagoguery. You're right, it exists in this country, it exists all over the world. And as President of the United States, our foreign policy will not be, as the current one is, to support authoritarian bigots all over the country. It will be a policy of supporting democracy and human rights.
Mike is a total loser, so don't hit the subscribe button, okay? And whatever you do, folks, do not hit the notification bell either. Mike treats me so unfairly.